Danielle Francis says, reasons ferritin would be low, 15 nanograms per milliliter, when hemochromatosis iron overload is present through very high transferrin saturation in serum and low unbound iron binding capacity. When treating it overload by a blood loss in the past, the ferritin continued to drop. Danielle, I answered a very similar question in the last AMA from Chris Morell. And so I'll answer this, but I would encourage people who are interested in this question to also listen to the last AMA to get some extra details there. So ferritin is your long-term iron storage, and transferrin is your short-term iron storage. And the problem with hemochromatosis is that usually in a normal functioning system, there is a hormonal regulatory system that prevents you from absorbing iron from food when you have enough iron, and that when you have too much iron, shuttles the iron into ferritin, which is protective both against pathogens eating the iron to grow and against oxidative stress, which free iron causes, which, if you don't know the details about, can be thought of as wear and tear on your tissues over time. And in hemochromatosis, the defect is that transferrin, normally the way you judge how much iron you have is in the circulating transferrin pool, which is your short-term storage, how full is it? And so the defect in hemochromatosis is that when the short-term storage, transferrin, starts getting fuller than usual, you don't notice it. So you don't stop absorbing iron from food. That makes the transferrin saturation go up even further. But you don't shuttle the iron into ferritin. That makes ferritin lower. What people get confused by is that historically, we have only paid attention to hemochromatosis when it's too late, when the person's been suffering for it from 30 or 40 years and they need organ transplants. And so what happens at that point is that the ferritin is very, very high. Why is the ferritin high? Not because you had too much iron. The person without hemochromatosis has the ferritin go up when they have too much iron. The defect in hemochromatosis is that you do not stop absorbing from food when you have enough, and you do not put the iron into ferritin when you have too much. The reason that ferritin is high in someone who's had hemochromatosis for 30 or 40 years is not because they have too much iron. It is because they have oxidative stress and damage caused by that iron. Oxidative stress and damage causes ferritin to go up no matter how much iron you have. So does infection, no matter how much iron you have. And so it essentially, what you have is ferritin is not the fireman that he should be, to put out the fire as it starts and the smoke detectors go off. Ferritin in hemochromatosis is the cleanup crew who got to the fire after the house burned down. And so the question is, why would ferritin be low in hemochromatosis iron overload when transferrin saturation is very high? And the answer is because you haven't had hemochromatosis for 40 years. And if these are your results, I believe, then you are female. And I'm not sure your age, but in general, females compared to males are powerfully protected against iron overload because of the blood loss that occurs during menstruation. And so if these are female data, then you're like 20 or 30 years behind a man of the same age. You know, even for a postmenopausal female who's 65, there's like 30 year, and I know there's variation in blood loss through the degree of menstrual flow, but still, just take the average female. The average female is like at 70 years old, is like, if they have hemochromatosis, they're like a man who's 30 with hemochromatosis. That's barely the beginning of problems starting to arise, because Danielle is 27 and the midwife is concerned about her levels. So Danielle, like a man who's 27, who has hemochromatosis genetics, would never be diagnosed with hemochromatosis by the standard conventional historical criteria because it's just not bad enough yet. So a woman who's 27, you know, of course your ferritin's going to be low because you're looking at this happening 40 years before you would see the blood markers that are expected. So you probably, I don't know who diagnosed you with hemochromatosis, but you probably you're looking at the genetics and you're looking at the blood markers that I recommend. So you're looking at it way before the fact. So should you be concerned about the ferritin? Well, look, first of all, I'm not a doctor. And so you have to not take my answer as treatment and pregnancy management advice, but I'll answer this in the context of, you know, what I would do myself if I were in that situation. So if I were in that situation, I would be knowing what I know about iron physiology, I would be assuming that the low ferritin is not indicating that your total body iron stores are low. It's indicating a problem with the feedback loop. So my suspicion is going to be that your thyroid is probably fine, which would not be fine in iron deficiency, and that your hemoglobin and your red blood cell count is probably fine, which it would not be in iron deficiency. And so I would not be donating blood leading into the pregnancy because I think you want I don't know what the recommendations around pregnancy are in this, but I imagine that you would want to have the full capacity of your body at your disposal. And so I wouldn't do anything depleting anything leading into pregnancy unless it was strongly warranted. But would I be worried that my ferritin was low? Not the ferritin, but I would probably look at my thyroid markers and I would look at a complete blood count to make sure that I wasn't anemic and I wasn't hypothyroid. If I wasn't anemic and I wasn't hypothyroid, I would conclude that the low ferritin was not an issue.